إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد Alhamdulillah, brothers and sisters, I had the chance to travel the past few weeks that I was out, and I had gone overseas. And one of the things that I wanted to talk about was something that unfortunately we see from every single place that we go. We all have maybe some of this inside of us, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help for us to get rid of these kind of negative qualities that find and seep their ways inside of us. And sometimes we're taught these little things based on the cultures that we're raised in. But it's something that you see across the world. And the Muslim community is not, you know, apart from the rest of the world. So even in our own countries, we have this problem. And this issue that, especially during travel that I saw, especially when I saw as a traveler, you know, you're in a cabin in an airplane, the way people speak to those that are serving you, when you land, the way people talk and deal with the people at the airport, when you're driving somewhere, you know, how people deal with the taxi driver or so on and so forth, but dealing with people in the community without humility. And this is something that, you know, is a very essential part of our faith, something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with specifically. Even though the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam already was the most humble human being that you can ever imagine, still Allah azza wa jal in the Quran commands the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be humble towards the believers and to be humble and, you know, behave with humility towards other people as well. And you want to take a look at this example of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because there are so many aspects in our lives or chances that we get in our lives to deal with people, and unfortunately sometimes we deal with them in a way that's not humble or that's not considered humility. And unfortunately it can plant seeds of arrogance and pride and thinking that we're better than other people because we have a different socioeconomic status, or because we speak a certain language, or because we're from a certain part of the world, or even because we're blessed with a certain faith, or whatever it is. We deal with people sometimes in a very rude way, in a very condescending way, because we don't feel that they are up to our level or up to our standards. And this is something that specifically the Prophet ﷺ in his practice and in his life never ever did. He never treated people like they were lowly, like they were beneath him, even if it was someone that really was, you know, considered the worst of society. Still, the Prophet ﷺ gave this person his full attention. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, he tells our Prophet ﷺ, he says, وَخْفِضْ جَنَاحَكَ لِمَنِ اتَّبَعَكَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, that lower your wing for those who are following you from amongst the believers. And this example that is given in the Arabic language, lower your wing, اخفض جناحك, right? Lower your wing. The scholars, they talk about how when a person is prideful and arrogant, or when a person thinks they're better than somebody else, it's like they see themselves like a bird that's just flying high, right? Out of touch, out of reach, this is me and you're down there on the ground. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says, واخفض جناحك للمؤمنين, right? In another ayah as well, that, you know, lower your wing, lower your wing. Don't expect people to come up to you. Don't think that don't have that expectation that even because of your status as a prophet, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, don't have that expectation that they should come to you, but you rather lower your wing to them, right? You fly down to them and see what they need. So lower your wing, be humble towards those who are following you from amongst the believers. And this is something that we have to try to implement in our lives as well. Many times we deal with people and we deal with them purposefully. Sometimes we think we have to talk to people in a way that's condescending, otherwise they won't listen. Right, and mostly that's because we haven't tried the other way, or we haven't really given it a fair chance. But we really feel like, no, you have to talk to these people in this way, otherwise they won't listen. And that's not the case. If anyone in this world, if any human being or any human beings
had the right or have the right to be to behave in this manner where they think of themselves as better than other people, then these are the prophets of Allah. These are people chosen by Allah to deliver His message to all of mankind. If there's anyone that should behave or that would have the right to behave in such a manner, it would be the prophets of Allah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells His best messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَخْفِذْ جَنَاحَكَ لِمَنْ اتَّبَعَكَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. You have to lower your wing. You have to behave with humility towards the believers. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is being commanded with this, then what about us? Especially in our communities, in our families, in our circles, in general as well, with people, with all types of people. We should have this same level of humility. And Allah Azza wa Jal, some other ayat in the Quran that help us to understand this even more. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. This is an ayah we quote almost in every khutbah maybe, because it's an ayah that can talk about so many different things, but here specifically it's talking about being a humble person, having humility and recognizing that the diversity that exists around you is something that is made by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So no one should have pride or arrogance to the level that they feel like they're better than somebody else based on gender. Why? Because Allah says, إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى. And this is something that we have inside our community, something that we suffer with as well. We tend to think of people of the opposite gender. Men specifically tend to think of women as less than them. Why? We don't know why. Allahu A'lam. But we don't think of them at the same level as us most of the time. And we think sometimes that because we're men that we're better. These are things that happen. Sometimes you question people why problems are happening, and then they end up spilling out, hey, well, this is really why. Because she is like this and I am like this, and she can't think this way and I can't think this way. Right? And this is something that Allah Azza wa Jalla says, I have made you and you are the product of a man and a woman. So don't think you're better than the other gender because you are a product of both. You are a mixture of both. You come from both. So if you're saying you're better than one, it doesn't make any sense whatsoever, because you are a product of both of these things put together. And we made you into different nations and different tribes. So don't be arrogant and prideful that I come from such and such a lineage, or I come from such and such a country, or an ethnicity, or whatever. Unfortunately, people sometimes they scoff at other people because of their background, right? Don't talk to these people or don't deal with these people, they're like this, right? And you can fill in the blanks. All of us have been raised in a culture that told us specifically that these types of people are like this. Maybe when it comes to business, maybe when it comes to dealing, maybe when it comes to marriage, maybe when it comes to telling the truth or lying or stealing or whatever it is. But we've all been taught to fill in these blanks with a certain type of label for a certain type of person. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says, I am the one that made you into different nations and different tribes, different languages and different colors, right? None of this is a reason for you to think of yourself better than somebody else. And he says, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The only quality that really makes you better than somebody else is your obedience to Allah. And then Allah caps off the verse by saying, I am the only one that knows this. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. Nobody knows this except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we don't need to have this arrogance or this pride in any of these circumstances. These are all your relationships with people, whether it's based on gender, whether it's based on ethnicity, nationality, language, or whatever it is, you should not feel that you are better than somebody else. Because these are the seeds of arrogance and pride, and this is something, as we'll see, is something that's very, very dangerous as well. And Allah Azza wa Jalla even tells us in the Quran, He says, فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Don't claim righteousness for yourselves. Don't claim that you yourself are purified. Allah is the most knowing of the one who is most obedient to Him. Even when it comes to religious matters, sometimes we discriminate people on the basis of religiosity. Right? If we consider ourselves practicing, then sometimes we may discriminate or treat other people who we don't feel are as religious as we are with some kind of condescending manner. Right? Unfortunately, sometimes people will, because of their own sense of piety, may yell at somebody who doesn't know any better. Unfortunately, sometimes these are real stories. Unfortunately, they happen here as well. People have told us they're going to visit a masjid. Someone is going to visit a masjid for the very first time. They're trying to learn about Islam. And the minute they walk in the door, the people don't recognize this is a new person. They yell at them because they're not covered properly, or because they walked in with their shoes into the masjid. These are things that happen here as well in our communities. We have to be very, very careful about how we treat other people and deal with other people. We have no idea. Just because we think that we are religious or practicing, we should not treat people in a condescending manner who in our perception, in our own perception, we feel are not as religious as we are. Again, Allah says He is the only one that knows who really is the most obedient to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we have to be careful about that as well. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in an interesting ayah in the Quran, when He talks about Ahlul A'raf, the people of Al-A'raf,
He says, وَنَادَ أَصْحَابُ الْأَعْرَافِ رِجَالٍ يَعْرِفُونَهُمْ بِسِيمَاهُمْ قَالُوا مَا أَغْنَى عَنْكُمْ جَمْعُكُمْ وَمَا كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَكْبِرُونَ أَهَؤُلَاءِ الَّذِينَ أَقْسَمْتُمْ لَا يَنَالُهُمُ اللَّهُ بِرَحْمَةٍ ادْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةَ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْكُمْ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ تَحْزَنُونَ.
The people of Al-A'raf are those people on the Day of Judgment who will have their good and bad deeds be equal. So they don't have enough to go to Jannah, and yet they don't have bad enough deeds to go to the hellfire. They will be placed on a height, an elevation. That's the meaning of Al-A'raf, the elevations. So they will be on this elevation, and they'll be able to see the people of Jannah, and they'll be able to see the people of the hellfire. And Allah Azza wa Jalla describes something that they will say, and it's very interesting. Very, very interesting. So he says, and the companions of the elevations will call out to the people of the hellfire, whom they recognize by their mark, saying, of no avail to you was your gathering, or your power and your strength in numbers, nor the fact, and that you were arrogant. There are two things that they describe the people of the hellfire with. They said, number one, you thought your numbers, your power, your help, your whatever that you had in this world, your backup, that was going to save you, but that didn't help you whatsoever. And it also didn't help the fact that you were arrogant about all of this. وَمَا كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. You were arrogant. You had pride. You thought yourself better than us because you had more numbers or more power or whatever that you had. So you were arrogant and you thought that your numbers would save you, but none of this has anything to do with you. Who are the people that are saying this to the people of Jahannam? They're the people whose bad deeds and good deeds are kind of equal, so they haven't even gone into Jannah yet. And they're giving a lecture to the people of the hellfire that this is what you how you used to behave. But you notice one thing about these people that's going to save them, and Allah says He's going to send them into Jannah, He will forgive them, He will have His mercy, and they will go to Jannah. Right? May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us from beyond these people, inshallah, maybe be amongst the ones who will go into Jannah and not have to go on the A'raf. But these people will be forgiven and entered into paradise, and it even shows you that people who are sinful to the point where their good deeds and bad deeds were equal, at least they don't have this quality of arrogance. They don't have this quality of arrogance and pride, and they don't treat people in a condescending manner that I am better or my power. This is something that if we have, this is a quality of the people of the hellfire, and the people that are struggling to make it to Jannah will be criticizing the people of the hellfire for this as well. So this is something, if we find the seeds of arrogance and pride inside of us, it's something very dangerous. We need to get rid of it so that we don't end up amongst those people that will be described like this on the Day of Judgment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always protect us. عن عياد بن حمار رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله أوحى إلي أن تواضعوا حتى لا يفخر أحد على أحد ولا يبغي أحد على أحد رواه مسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Allah has revealed to me, part of the faith, when he says أوحى إلي, that Allah عز وجل has given me wahi, had revelation. He says, Allah has revealed to me that you should humble yourselves. You should humble yourselves. One should neither hold himself above another person, nor should they transgress against one another. And transgressing and eating up people's rights, it's a violation of being humble and humility. Right? So don't think of yourself more deserving or better than somebody else, and then don't eat up their rights. Don't transgress against them. Don't commit wrongs against them. You know, don't violate their rights as well. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah has revealed to me that you should humble yourself. In very, very plain and clear terms. And the Prophet ﷺ said, مَا نَقَصَتْ صَدَقَةٌ مِّنْ مَالٍ وَمَا زَادَ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا بِعَفْوٍ إِلَّا عِزَّةٍ وَمَا تَوَادَ أَحَدٌ لِلَّهِ إِلَّا رَفَعُهُ اللَّهُ رَوَاهُ مُسْلِمٍ. The Prophet ﷺ said that wealth will not be decreased from you giving in sadaqah. When you give in sadaqah, Allah will not take away from your wealth. There's an aspect of humility in this. And he says, Allah will only increase a servant in honor if he's willing to forgive. If he's willing to forgive, Allah will increase that person in honor. And he said, no one humbles himself before Allah except that Allah will raise his ranks. Now you may think that only the last part has to do with humility, but all three of these have to do with humility. Why is the Prophet ﷺ telling us that your wealth will not be marred or taken away from if you give in sadaqah? Because we have to be humble enough and have the humility within ourselves to give to people when people ask, when they need money, and when we see that they are struggling, we should be able to help them. And the problem is that we'll think, well, our wealth is going to go down. How are we going to take care of ourselves? And the Prophet ﷺ said, your wealth will not decrease if you give in sadaqah. So this is something we should constantly do as well. And it takes a little bit of humility to be able to give in charity to others and from our own wealth. And he said that if you forgive someone, Allah will raise you in honor. This is something that requires humility, very clearly. A lot of times, we don't forgive people because of our own egos, our hurt pride. Right? How could they do this to me? How could they say that to me? How could they behave like this? How could they do? These are excuses we come up with, but all of it has to do with my pride is hurt. My ego is hurt. How could they do this to me? That's the thing we put at the end. How could they do this to me? Not how could they do this, period. And usually it's always, always very forgivable, right? Of course, there are things that may be unforgivable. Those are individual cases and things like that. But in general, these are things that we can forgive. Family disputes, community disputes, disputes we have with our friends, all these little types of things that get in the way of moving communities and people forward, usually are things we can forgive, but we don't forgive because how could they do this to me? And they did this to me, I will never forget. Right? And so we think that by not forgiving, we are preserving our honor. And the Prophet ﷺ is telling us the exact opposite. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase your honor if you forgive. He will increase your honor if you forgive. And if you humble yourself before Allah, if you are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you have the opportunity to disobey and you obey, this is humbling yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every time you obey Allah, you are humbling yourself before Him. Especially when you have the opportunity to do something wrong and you decide not to, you are humbling yourself before Allah. Allah says He will raise you in ranks. He will raise you in ranks. Part of our pride and ego leads us towards trying to get titles and reputations and statuses in this world that we will be recognized for. But all of these things will finish, right? One day you will die, time will eventually forget you, and even on the day of judgment when the world is destroyed, all of what you did will be gone. But if you have a rank, a status, a reputation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? If you have a rank, status, and reputation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ حَيٌّ لَا يَمُوتُ. Allah azza wa jalla is eternal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is eternal. That remembrance of you will be eternal, right? فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. If you remember Allah, Allah will remember you. That remembrance is eternal. So if we focus on developing our reputation for Allah, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whoever humbles himself before Allah, Allah will raise his ranks. And these are ranks, this is a status, this is a level that will never be decreased by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was known to be humble with every member of his community. And this is something that we want to get to. With every member of his community, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was known to be humble with. كان نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, Anas radiallahu anhu, مر على سبيان فسلم عليهم وقال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يفعله. That Anas radiallahu anhu, the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, walked by a group of young boys and he said salam to them. And then he turned to his companion and he said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do this. He used to say salam to young children. Now we teach young children that you have to say salam to your adults, right? But unfortunately what happens is sometimes again our ego gets in the way. So if we're standing as adults and you see a group of children pass by, you wait, you wait, you wait, they come and they go, and then you're upset. They didn't say salam. What kind of kids are these? They didn't say salam. But what else happened? You didn't say salam either, right? No, we didn't give the salam either. And the Prophet ﷺ, again, didn't have the expectation that young children are going to say salam to me. His action was to go and say salam to them. And that's what taught the companions of the Prophet ﷺ to behave in this way. That's what taught their kids to say salam first. Was they didn't have the expectation that you need to say salam first. Their reaction was, I'm going to say salam whenever I see a child or a kid or anybody else. And so they would always do that as well. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, again, as it was known, as one of the Anas radiallahu anhu narrated as well, that a slave girl, a young slave girl from Medina, on the streets of Medina, would come and grab the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she would talk to him and take him somewhere, and he would go with her. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a very busy man. He's the leader of the city of Medina. There's an empire being built and he's walking in the street and a child comes and grabs his hand and decides to go and have a conversation and he goes, right? And this was the humility of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? In our times, it's unimaginable. It's hard to think, right? If somebody comes of importance, they shut down the streets, there's a security protocol, you can't even go and shake the person's hand, they're behind bulletproof glass and all of this kind of stuff. But our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and many of the leaders, many of the righteous leaders, didn't have this attitude. Again, the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for their security, but they were part of their people. They were with their people. They never held themselves to a higher standard amongst their people. So when even in busy times, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was really busy, he would go off with a little girl with Medina who would come and take his hand. Now this teaches us a very important lesson, especially when it comes to our children. When it comes to being humble and having humility with our children, if we are busy doing something and you have a young child and they come to you, put aside what you're doing. SubhanAllah, this is difficult to say, it's difficult to do. It takes a lot of patience, especially when you're busy with work or you're doing something that you think is important. There's nothing more important than developing that love and relationship with your child. That's going to be a long-term relationship. Your work can be done later. You can cram it later or anything like that. But when your child comes running to you, right? Because soon enough, they'll be running away from you, right? That's the reality. But when they come running to you, those are moments that you don't want to let pass by. Whatever you're doing, if you're messaging someone, if you're on the phone, if you're doing some work, put it down and give that attention to your child. These actions that we learn from the Prophet ﷺ have long-term effects. They have long-term effects. It helps build that love and relationship, and it tells your child that when you come to me, I will listen. And eventually your child will grow up and they will come to you with a problem, and you know they will know that when I go to my parent, they will listen. This is a learned habit that happens from a very young age, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us and pardon us, but we ask Allah azza wa jal to give us the wisdom to be able to recognize these opportunities, these little bitty opportunities, and take advantage, full advantage of them as well. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Aisha radiallahu anha, she said about him, ما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصنع في بيته, when she was asked what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in his house, قالت كان يكون في مهنة أهله, يعني خدمة أهله. فإذا حضرت الصلاة خرج إلى الصلاة, رواه البخاري. Aisha, when she was asked how was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with his family at home, she said he was always in the service of his family, and when the time for prayer came, he would leave and go perform the prayer. Right, so meaning when he was at home, he was with his family. Right, and he was in the khidmah. I mean, he was serving his family. He wasn't sitting around getting served tea and coffee and, you know, other people doing his chores. He was serving and helping in his family in the house. Unfortunately, it's again, some of our cultural pride and ego tells us that as men, we can't do certain chores in the house. Right, and it's looked down upon if a man is doing certain chores in the house, if he's washing the dishes or doing the laundry. Sometimes we've been programmed to think that this is not something that I'm supposed to be doing. Right, but the Prophet ﷺ, his example is the exact opposite. He would mend his own shoes, fix his own clothes, he would help out in the house. And none of these things took away from the manliness of Rasulullah ﷺ. He was at the height that you can never imagine of manliness and what he had of manhood. But this was his behavior in his own household. He was at the service of his family. He would help out. He would take care of his own chores and so on and so forth. He would, you know, milk the goats and all this kind of stuff. He would do everything that he needed to do. Everything that everybody else in the house would do, he would do as well. And this is something that we need to be more humble and have more humility about as well. And again, these little things go a long way. They build the relationships you have in your house. When your family sees you at their service, when your family sees that you're not sitting on a pedestal and expecting to be served, but rather you're there to help and serve them as well, these are things that help mend these relationships and these family ties and make these bonds more ever stronger. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with the ability to understand the importance of being a humble person, the importance of having humility, especially in dealing with our own families, because that's number one, that's our number one priority and our number one responsibility when it comes to how we are treating those in our own household. Not to be condescending, not to talk down to them, but to be humble and to give them attention when they need it. And wider as well when it comes to our communities, when it comes to how we deal with our families, that these are things that go a long way. But as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I'll close with this ayah, he said in the Quran, that the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith that no one will enter Jannah who has the tiniest amount of arrogance in his heart. This is why the people of Araf will look at the people of Jahannam and say, you were arrogant. This is why you're here. At least we weren't arrogant, but you were arrogant. And the Prophet ﷺ said very clearly, no one will enter Jannah who has the tiniest bit of kibr, of arrogance in his heart, who thinks that they are better than somebody else. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla's protection from feeling like this. We seek Allah Azza wa Jalla's help from dealing with the programming that we've been raised, unfortunately sometimes to think with and to act with when it comes to how we talk and deal with other people. And we always in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ ذَنْبٍ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ